even have my browser open, but it looks okay. Well, my cameraman tells me that we are online live, finally, here at a very, very wet Donington Park. Good evening, everybody. It's the STC, the Sim Racing Team Challenge, and the players have been waiting for a clean start here for the third lap now. It's lap number three that they have been following the pace car, but we understand that after some tussles in the back of the field, this time now everything is clean and we are supposed to have a start at the end of this, the third outlap, so you have missed none of the action indeed. Let me give you a very, very quick rundown of the field, but while the camera stays in one place, and that is the front of the grid, so you won't lose any of the action. But just to keep you informed where each of the guys is. In position number one, we have Ben Pusting for Team Game Racer, flat out the defending champions. In position number two, Robin Johansson for Gubkluben. In three, Dinka Andre for Waterblue Racing. In four, Marco Giuliato for Corus Online. In five, Nicola Dorigatti, also Corus Online. In six, Daniel Beck for Gubkluben. In seven, Nathan Eljo, first of the clubbers from Game Player, flat out. In eight, for Torrent Motorsports, Reggie Blaine. In nine, Michael Chabot for Waterblue Racing. In 10, first of the Black Rebels, Andreas Löffler. In 11, Tom Ilsbrooks, the guy behind flat out. In 12, Guge Hultmann for Gubkluben UD. Then in 13, his teammate Erling Böhmer. In 14, it is Adam Shaw for flat out proper. In 15, it is Chris Jock. And as you see, the action going on the way now, because David Garcia moves into the pit lane. We concentrate on T1 with Ben Tusting, and there's the first attack there. There's the first tussle between Dinka Andre and between Marco Giuliato, but Andre has fended off Giuliato. Tusting moves into the Craner curves at top speed, and we see that Johansson is already out on the grass but can stick to his speed. There's the top six, there's a little gap, and then there's the rest of the field. Tusting still out in front, and he is followed by that Gubkluben Corvette there with Robin Johansson emitting a lot of sparks here. And Tusting has trouble as they run into Coppice. They're on the way now up to Coppice, and he had trouble putting the power down of the Koenigsegg, and again he has trouble. And if Johansson can just brave it out now, if Johansson can just stay there, stick it out, they may have an interesting run down Starkey Strait. And Tusting squeezes in front as they head into the SS turn number 9. And Tusting stays in front. But now here's the next attack by Robin Johansson. It's a very interesting first lap here. Going now towards Melbourne hairpin. Johansson on the inside and just barely misses Tusting there. Tusting again all over the place, really with huge problems, as has Dinka Andre, who is under constant threat there by the Corus Online player, by Marco Giuliato. And now it's Johansson who's sliding, and it's Dinka Andre who's sliding, and Tusting has a little bit of an advantage here as they leave, as they head out of lap number three it is, or lap number one of the first of the race proper here, and into T1 for the second time. What a first lap here, as Ben Tusting is struggling mightily to keep Göran Johansson Robin Johansson behind here at a very, very, very wet Donington. Donington that fooled everybody with sun being actually on the forecast, and then just this morning the forecast switched to rain in the race, and it is raining indeed. It's raining more heavily than ever this season. We had wet races already in Spa and then last session in Hockenheim, but this one is a really, really wet one with little chance of drying up. So time to take a breath. No, not time to take a breath, as we see Robin Johansson sticking very close indeed to Ben Tusting, who has huge problems. And now Tusting makes a mistake in the S's. Tusting makes a mistake. He was too late on the break going into the S's. He slid through the S's, and that gives Johansson just the tiny little gap he's been waiting for. And Tusting eager now to avenge himself. Tusting eager to get back into the action. But Tusting is all over the place. And this, in fact, gives Andre a chance to move in closer. Andre now very close, overshooting his breakpoint as they go into Goddard's. And Johansson leads the field as they head out of T2. In the back, there's a push. In the back, there's a little push. By back, he touches the second. That's Dorigati. Touches Dorigati. Dorigati has to go onto the grass, and Dorigati is now down to 7.
No,
Johansson
wait.
Also with some problem. Yes.
Andreas.
David. Andreas, I'm Eckhart, but never mind. David, there you are. After three long laps in the pace car, what's the comment?
Well, the comment was that it was not Nicola Dorigati. It was Marco Giulietto who missed his breaking
point.
I'm sorry. Went out on the final corner, and in his way back to the track, he was hit by
Beck.
Think it was Daniel Beck. Yeah, exactly.
Daniel Beck. Yep, I didn't. It was just at the back of my screen, so you obviously had a better chance to watch it. Is it actually very, very virtually wet out there in Donington? So see all the players, all the guys here with huge problems laying down the power. It must be extremely wet.
Yeah. I would say it is the worst condition we had on STC before.
Yep. And if we look at the virtual sky here, it is definitely very, very dark indeed. Well then, a very close fight here for the top already in the first laps. But now it seems to have cooled down a little as they have finished their lap number 3. After 3 outlaps, it's Johansson still leading. It's Ben Tusting, who has won a race in last season. Let's not forget that. So both of them have been high up on the podium here. And following them is Dink Andre for Waterblue Racing, who are not usually that high up at front. That's a bit of a surprise here, but those of you who followed Dinka on Race Department, they know that he is one of the top guys as well, and very, very fast indeed, and he really manages to play to the strengths of the Sonder here, and the strengths are obviously not in the high speed, but in the peaceful behavior. That's called a peaceful behavior in turns, and behind Dinka, there is a huge gap. And cameraman Chausse, if you have sorted out the technical problems that we had just right up to the start, as usual, would we be able to do a rundown now to show our viewers the gaps that have already opened up in the field?
Yes, I think it's a good idea.
Well, brilliant. Then it's Andre in 3, and there's the first of the gaps, and that is to Nicola Dorigati. Thank you, David, for putting me right. It is indeed Dorigati here in one of the very aggressively painted or skinned Audis of Course Online. He is in 4. That's a very nice surprise here to see the Course Online chaps that high up the grid after serious trouble that they had at Hockenheim. And Daniel Beck, as we noticed, up to 5. He was 6 on the grid. And then in 7, there is a huge fight here between Marco Giulietto, who dropped from 4 to 7, 3 positions down for him, unfortunately, already in 3 laps. And he is followed by the fastest of the junior team of Game Racer flat out, and this is Nathan Aljo. Nathan Aljo stuck to his position, basically, still in 7. But following very closely. And then we have a hugely, a densely packed group here in 8. It's Reggie Blaine for Torrent Motorsports, and he is followed by the first of the Black Rebels, Andreas Löffler. And Andreas really is in a serious trouble here because he is followed by what must surely be the fastest mover up the grid. It is one of the Flying Dutchman racing Corvettes who is all over Andreas Isensbeck. And that should be Jesper Talborg. Yes, indeed, it is. A quick guy, Jesper Talborg. And they actually had a problem in communication, so they had to be moved to the back of the grid. And unfortunately this morning, very, very sad when they got the news, but nothing could be done. And so they started from, Talborg started from way back in 19. Can you believe it? He's already up to 9 in 3 laps. And Andreas is giving him a hell of a fight here, trying to keep him back as best as he can. But I suppose it'll only be a matter of another lap or so till Jesper finds a little gap. So Loeffler in 9 in the Martek, and then in the Corvette, Jesper Talborg in 10. Then down in 11, Gugge Hultmann of Gubklubben UD in the Apollo. Gumpert in 12. Marcin van Bommel, another chap who had to start from the very, very back of the grid, position 20, in fact, or 21, I'm not quite sure, but anyway, he's up to 12 already. He is followed by Adam Shaw in 13, second of the flat-out guys, moving up the grid much more slowly than the Flying Dutchman. And Erling Böhmer of Gubklubben UD in 14, under heavy, heavy pressure indeed. One of the black and gold Salines here of AB Racing, that's Alexandre Gaetano, who was down in, I think, 23. This team also was not able to take part in the qualification Super Pole lap, and he also now has to fight his way on a wet Donington track. And we see just now that Van Bommel has moved up one position there. And but we move down the grid. Fernando Bento is out of the race. That's the second of the AB Racing cars. That's too bad.
He did not Tom start Eckhart.
He wasn't. Anyway.
Guys, he did start the race.
But oh, dear.
You know, I used to do an extra lap once the race is started. I used to follow the group for one lap.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was stopped in the grass in the second sector.
Oh, dear.
So he had a problem with his car. I can't tell you what happened, but there was a yellow flag on sector 2.
Okay, so serious problems there. And a massive fight here just in front of Tom Ilsbrooks for Game Racer Flat Out Club. And there's all sorts of action going on there with Alexandre Gaetano trying to slip past the Gubklubben guys. But Tom Ilsbrooks takes it easy, just watches what's going on, and then obviously hoping for a chance that opens up now as the Gubklubben player Erling Böhmer is out on the grass, on the very, very wet and slippery grass. He now closes the door to that Waterloo player number 2 there. And Ilsbrooks manages to squeeze just past, and Gubklubben guy Erling Böhmer is down to 16, while we have Ilsbrooks in 15, and we have Michael Chabot for Waterloo Racing in position number 17. So some very intense fights going on in this group, but let's first have a look at the back of the grid, so to see where everybody is and what's going on, and then we will definitely come back to one of these fighting groups here. So in 18, it's Nick Dealey for Flying Dutchman Development, another team that had to start from the very, very back. Then in 19, it's Chris Jacques for the Black Rebels in the Martek. He obviously lost some positions. He was in 15, but let's not forget that some of the really fast guys had to start from the back of the grid, so that was to be expected. It's Christa Larsson for my team for Blue Flag Racing, overshooting. Sorry, Christa. The first time we catch you on the screen, you overshoot the S's. Obviously, very sorry for that one. But back on track, that's the last surviving blue flagger. We saw that, unfortunately, Mark Warmington seems to have had some problem with his line, and he had to leave the server just as we switched to race session. And John McCartney for Torrent Motorsports in 21, already a good way off down the field with serious problems here in the wet. Maybe he picked the wrong tires at the beginning of the race and is now hoping for the track to dry up. And that's it. That's 21 guys still on the grid with 24 at the beginning of the race already. In the first 7 laps or so, we've lost 3 guys here at Donington. But, well, it's a very difficult situation here with the heavy rain. And that, of course, just means it's hugely difficult just to stay on the gray stuff, let alone stay on the gray stuff at some speed. And as I promised, we're moving back to that fighting club here in the middle of the pack where there's huge action going on. It's spread out a little, but it's still Tom Ilsbrooks who is fending off the attacks of Erling Böhme. And Ilsbrooks managed to squeeze past earlier on, but now it's Böhme all over his back and trying to make a move at every possible little turn there, trying to find just a small gap. And right now it looks as if Ilsbrooks has managed to pull away just a little, but let's wait and see it. And there's another huge fight, cameraman tells me, in 13 and 14. And yes, let's move there. It's Adam Shaw, who's just now out on the grass. And this gives AB Racing guy Alexandre Gaetano the chance he's been looking for, the gap he's been waiting for. And he's, and now Gaetano is having problem. But he, great move there by Gaetano. He stays in control. I saw him losing that Saline as he headed out of Coppice, but now into the S's. Very late approach, and they touch. Very late approach into the S's by Gaetano. Nothing, in fact, that Adam Shaw for Game Racer Flat Out could do there. He was just on the break. No way he could go. No place he could go there. And he touched Gaetano, but no harm done. Adam Shaw then stepped on the brakes, moved back from the tussle, and so it's Shaw in 13, it's Alexandre Gaetano in 12, and Gaetano here with serious problem, as has Shaw, getting the power down on the start of Wheatcroft Strait. Oh, there you are, Timmy. Long time no see. You were totally absent in Hockenheim. Don't you like Germany? Oh, well. Great to have you back here, and a very rainy race is it that you see. I hope you don't get a little heart attack from all the action that we see here. Right now we see that Gaetano is moving very quickly away, so let's hope that Adam Shaw has not damaged anything on the Koenigsegg. Let's follow Adam Shaw for a while, Chaussé, because it looks to me as if poor Adam has some problems with his steering now. After that touch with Gaetano, where nothing he could do really, that Gaetano was all over the place in the S's. And in the background, following Adam Shaw, we see that Gutklubben's Erling Böhme has or is trying to make that move on Tom Ilsbrooks that he's been waiting for. And Ilsbrooks just manages to squeeze past again. So there's all kinds of action here. 13, 14, 15 is really where the music is at here at rainy Donington in the STC. And would you believe it or not, I got a whisper the first time in my life from a squirrel, and the squirrel, using the TeamSpeak whisper, tells me there's a huge fight in P10. Yeah, you little fellow. Anyway, yeah, P10 is a good place to go, because here we see that Andreas Löffler is fending off the attacks of Martin van Bommel of Flying Dutchman Racing, and Löffler, who had to let Talborg pass, obviously. Talborg is slightly up the grid. We find him in position 8 at this point. But Löffler is fending off Martin van Bommel here at Donington. And they are now out of McLean's on that small hill up to Coppice. And the Martek does have a funny sound, does it? It sounds as if it's just, I don't know what, it sounds like an electric car, really. It doesn't have much of a sound. Mostly you can hear the tires, I think.
Yeah. It's not sounding like a pure American car, I would say.
Not at all. Ooh, and sound or not sound, Loeffler loses it as he heads out of the S's. Van Bommel, trying to get out of the way, loses it as well, is onto the grass. Loeffler can recover, and he stays in front miraculously. But you see what happens is, if you do this too often, you have Gaetano following you, because Alexandre has moved very close to these two. And Martin Van Bommel, he's very well advised, to take advantage now, as Loeffler has the next problem. Van Bommel slips past. They're heading out onto onto Wheatcraft Strait, and Van Bommel is past Loeffler. And I don't think that Andreas is in a position to start a counterattack. In fact, he now has to defend from Alexandre Gaetano. But José, let's move away from these three, and let's move even higher up the grid, because I saw that there is action where Jesper Talborg is. Because there's a group fighting very, very closely here in 6, 7, 8, and 9. 6, we have Daniel Beck of Gupkluben. In 7, we have Reggie Blaine, his home event here at Donington, obviously. And in 8, we have Jesper Talborg, stuck for a moment on his way up the grid. And in 6, Nathan Aljo, fastest of the Game Racer Flat Out Clubs. And that is a group really fighting on the same level. And we have Reggie Blaine making a move on Daniel Beck. Reggie Blaine in Melbourne, he squeezes past, and he is now our new... Ow! And Daniel Beck there loses it as he tries to follow Reggie Blaine as closely as he possibly can. And with a little bit of bad luck, Daniel Beck will be... caught by that Van Bommel group in the back, but he can recover. Obviously, he can recover pretty quickly here, and that takes him. And he's into the pits. The first of the pit stops. Daniel Beck is into the grids. Into the pits, not into the grids. And there's a whole group of guys into the pits. It's all the Corvettes pitting in. It's both of the Flying Dutchmen, and it's Daniel Beck, and we see Gupkluben UD player, I think Erling Böhmer also coming into the pits there. So lots of action here already in the pits. And we're moving to the top of the grid now, because Dinka Andre is mounting an attack on Robin Johansson. But just as we go there, Johansson takes all the action out of the race at the top. And we have a new race leader, as basically everybody is moving into the pits. It's Ben Tusting into the pits, but Dinka Andre stays out. And we have a new race leader. It's Dinka Andre for Waterblue. And let's follow him for a moment. Let's have him as 15 minutes of fame here on SimRace TV, because he well deserves it. Dinka Andre leading the race here at Donington with a grey sky and lots of rain coming down.
Yeah.
He's in the Pagani Santo. Yes, David, it's not getting any better here, is it?
No. In fact, everybody's pitting, because I am sure that they are changing to wet tires. Just 30 minutes of the race gone. The track condition changed from damp to wet.
Yep.
It means they are going on wet tires.
Yep, and see that the one staying out really a lot, I mean, Dinka Andre, he's no slouch, and he's off the track in Coppice there for a moment, so it must be well-nigh impossible to control these GT Pro beasts with slicks. And we don't have intermediates anymore, because we can't use the mod we had in last seasons anymore, because we're away from modded cars, back to the original pack. And Andre here into Melbourne really has a handful of the... Pagani Zonta to just control it into Melbourne. Out of Melbourne, that little straight there behind the pits, and let's see if he is pitting as well, and let's see where he will rejoin. No, he stays out. Brave guy, Dinka Andre stays out, And that Gupkluben UD guy we see in the back is, in fact, a lap down. It's Robin Johansson in two, but having made a pit stop, he is down some 600, 800 meters. Should be about roughly a minute or 40 seconds there. And Dinka Andre now approaching another Pagani Zonda. That's Christer Larsson of Blue Flag Racing, who, again, is a lap down and will be blue flagged any moment now. But no, sorry, it's not Larsson. Sorry. Sorry, I mixed up the rights there. It's Nathan Aljo, I suppose, for the Game Racer Flat Out Club. Yes, I just saw something pink there flashing on my screen. It was a pink Flat Out Club skin, and it wasn't the pink Blue Flag skin. So Aljo about to be lapped, by Dinka Andre after about, 30 minutes or so at Donington. Well, it's not even 30. It's about 20 minutes on my watch. So really, it looks as if most of the guys went out on dries and then now decide it won't stop raining and we have to change to wets. Andre has passed Aljo, and let's for the second... Oh, look at that, that's more like Richard Burns here. Sliding into the turn and then sliding through. Cameraman just told me he got a little loss, and commentary didn't quite fit the action, but let me tell you that there is action where Dinka Andre is, even if he's all alone up in front. It's a pleasure, it's amazing to see him here in the wet conditions at Donington. Let me tell you, he's really coming down in buckets here. It's really raining cats and dogs all over the place here in northwest Leicestershire. Well, virtual northwest Leicestershire anyway. And now what I just told you is in fact happening. He's running up to Christer Larsson. Yes, David.
Yeah, sorry for the interruption, but I have some news from Matter Blue Racing, guys. Georgios Davakos just tell me that on their server, in their machines, in their computers, both cars are painted in black in honor to Dan Weldon.
Ah, okay.
It's a nice gesture from them.
I think it is. That's a very tragic moment, of course, in real life racing. That very awful crash, I think most of you, if not witnessed, at least later on read about and heard about, that took the life of Dan Weldon from Great Britain. Dinka Andre now still not pitting, nope, in fact speeding out onto Wheatcroft stage, straight here, and we see one of the Black Rebels in the pit, and the field now has completely, utterly spread with the different pit stop strategies, and Dinka Andre has a huge time gap. David, you're the guy I always send running. Could you tell us what the time difference is between Andre and Robin Johansson in position number two?
Yes, of course. They are separated by 30 seconds.
From Dinka Andre
to Robin Johansson. But from Robin Johansson to Marco Giuliato, there are 20 extra seconds.
Okay, so it's really, really spread out the field here. In the back, we see Christer Larsson off the track slightly in McLean's, but I'm sure he can recover that. And we see also that Nathan Aljo has huge problems just sticking to the gray stuff here. Where else, Andre? His lines are fairly clean, considering how difficult it must be. And a very clean run here through the S's, and hardly any twitch of the Zonta's back as he puts the power down, moves out onto Shield straight into Melbourne, and now uphill again behind the pits. But, ooh, yes, a little bit of a slide there as well. So must be very demanding indeed, but he is fully in control. Well, a great job here by Dinka Andre for Waterblue Racing. Ah, And the closest bet on the grid, as Andre has these 30 seconds between him and Robin Johansson, the by far closest bet on the grid is pole sitter Ben Tusting in position number 5, chasing Alexandre Gaetano, who came from, and now hold your breath, 23 on the grid. So they were 22 spaces apart on the grid, with Tusting actually in front of Gaetano. And now we have Gaetano in front of Tusting, position number 4 for AB Racing, position number 5 for Game Racer, flat out the defending champions. And oh, very close indeed here in the last turn in Goddard's, and now out onto the straight and moving into Red Gate. A very difficult turn to take, even in good conditions. Must be absolutely dreadful in these conditions, because look at that, Gaetano almost out on the grass, because that's what happens if you take too much speed through the turn. However, if you take too little speed through the turn, you're lost here in the Craner curves. You're definitely going to lose big time there. And Ben Tusting, very close indeed, but he's taking a very sensible approach here. He's avoiding a hit at any cost, from what I can see. It looks as if he's a bit faster than Gaetano, but it also looks as if he's playing it safe. He knows it's only 30 minutes done in a 90-minute race, and he could spoil it for both of them right now with being... Oh, and now he makes... No, he doesn't. Ah, that camera perspective. It looked as if he was trying to make a move out of Coppice, as Gaetano was really all over the place. And now into the S's. We've seen lots of action here before today, but this time it's all very clean indeed. And now virtually nibbling away at Gaetano's back there. And Gaetano now manages to take a very defensive line through Melbourne. And Tusting really is all over the place. Approaching Goddard's now. Moving, and Tusting takes a very, very, very tight line. Can he make it stick as they move out? Yes, he can, but it doesn't help him, because Gaetano makes it stick as well. He takes a careful approach into T1. He's leaving a lot of room for Tusting. And Tusting now trying to make a counter move on the inside. And there they touch, and Gaetano loses it. They touch, and Tusting is passed. Tusting has moved past a very sensible and very clever maneuver. Through Redgate, he took a very close line, hugging the inside, and then moving into first of the crane curves, he just managed to nip past Alexandre Gaetano, and Ben Tusting is up in 4, while Gaetano is now even off the track in McLean's, obviously trying too quickly to try and follow Ben Tusting. Look at that gap there as they move out onto Starkey's, and as they approach the S's. And I think Gaetano just has to find his rhythm again, and he doesn't have much time, because that's Jesper Talborg approaching in the back. He really doesn't have very much time here to come back to life, so to speak, to find his rhythm again. I don't know about you, David. If you've been in a fight for a long time, like 2, 3, 4 laps, and if then the fight is over, either way, whether you manage to defeat your opponent and move past, or whether you are the one who is defeated, I find it very difficult to get back into a sensible rhythm. Same with you?
Yeah, of course. I think it always takes a bit of the time to recover the fight pace. It's not the same being in a fight for 4 laps that being in a fight for 10 laps. You always need to rest, and I would say even that it is good for recover and go back again to the fight.
Yep, definitely. And this is, the ultimate recovery. Gaetano goes into the pits. I think it's a very, very sensible thing to do. He seemed to have lost his rhythm utterly. He was out on the grass one or two times in that half lap following the fight, and now he really has time to get back his concentration, to concentrate again on what he's about to do. And actually, rain is getting a little less, I would say, but that might just be my impression. And sky around Donington is clearing up just a little, but it might just be my screen here, so I'm not quite sure about that. Gaetano joins in position number 13, and let's have a look at one of the other fighting groups here around the grid. And as we leave Jesse Talborg, we move a little down the grid and we find his teammate, Marcin van Bommel, who just had a little tussle, a little get-together in the SS. This is where the action is tonight, in the SS, with the second Waterblue chap, with Michael Chabot. Michael Chabot for Waterblue and Pagani Zonta was overtaken, in fact, by Marcin van Bommel in the Corvette for Flying Dutchman Racing. And it seems that Chabot was also here just mightily defending his position, because right now van Bommel is moving away in great big strides here. And it may be that van Bommel has changed to wets while Chabot still out on dries. And it also may be that Chabot sustained some damage, because he is in position number 9, virtually limping round the track here if you compare his speed to that of van Bommel. And Chabot now is under attack by Nicola Dorigatti of Course Online. Dorigatti has had a very good evening till now tonight, at least from what we could see. And he's about to move into position number 9. Look at that. Approaching Coppice here, refraining from making a move there, but trying to get some good exit speed, as Chabot is just basically trying to get through Coppice alive. And look at that, very easily Dorigatti moves out as they move out on the straight, now into the brake zone, stays in control, nice and clean line through the SS, perfect move by Nicola Dorigatti, and that puts him in position number 9. Chabot into the pits now. And very much down the grid we travel to pick up on the latest news there. And it seems that by the time we spotted... I'm really missing Andreas Hultgren. Andreas, where are you? By the time we spotted, or I spotted, a fighting pair on the grid, they seem to have resolved the conflict. Just now saw Andreas Loffler in 17 for the Black Rebels, having quite a nice fight with Christer Larsson in 18 for the Blue Flag. And right now, as we move the camera there, Loffler has moved past, and look at the gap between them already. Larsson has... had to step back there, and so not much of a fight there, but I see that the Waterblue guy, that there's a Waterblue guy coming out of the pits, and I wonder if that's the race leader or whether it is actually Michael Chabot. No, it was Michael.
Yeah, I think it's Chabot. Back,
yep, he's back in 18 following Christer Larsson now, so two of the Pagani Zontas in 17 and 18. Ooh, and Loeffler in huge problems here, taking a massive slide. And I don't know if that was also on your screen, but he could recover. And the race leader is at the pits. And I've just pointed Jose that way. And the race leader is no longer the race leader. We have a new race leader, and that is Robin Johansson of the Gubklubben. He has moved past Dinka Andre, who is in the pits for the first time. And let's see. Let's stick with Dinka. Let's see where he comes out, and let's see how many positions he loses. He's done with fuel, and he's now changing tires. And he's down to 3. Because Marco Giuliato has just passed him in the pits. And Dinka Andre, he still stays in 3. There's a Flying Dutchman development Audi there. He stays in 3 as he moves out. And position number 4, Ben Tusting, is right now slipping past. Tusting in 3, Andre in 4, and Also, Jesper Talborg has slipped past. Talborg in 4, Andre in 5, and now it is Reggie Blaine who has slipped past. So he comes back out in 6. Dinka Andre now in 6. And I think this, for the first time in many, many laps, gives us something of a very clear idea of where exactly the racers are here on the grid. So we have Andre in 6. By the way, Marcin van Bommel in 7. And Jose, I think we should just move up the grid from here in tiny steps to see who is in 5, 4, 3, 2, and then stick with the race leader for some time. And Andre has trouble here in Goddard with the new tires, obviously. Has to get used to them. In position number 5, Reggie Blaine for Torrent Motorsports. He was in 8. On the grid, so he has profited from all the weather shenanigans here in his native Great Britain, and he's having a fine time around rainy Donington. He obviously knows the track very, very well indeed, and rain shouldn't be an element that he's unfamiliar with, and so he is definitely fine, even if it's only the virtual representation. Reggie Blaine in 5 now, approaching the last turn, Goddard's, and then out onto start and finish straight, which moves us to position number 4. Jesper Talborg, who is just down this start and finish straight, also gives you a rough idea of the gaps between the guys. Talborg, let's not forget, starting in 20, and now up to 4 already. Don't think there's very much room for improvement to the top, but 4, I think, is a fabulous result if you came from 20. That's Jesper for you. Moving up to 3. Also, rather close, and following Christer Larsson, who is nicely moving out of the way here, choosing a very safe spot to do so. That's Ben Tusting for the Game Racer flat out, the pole sitter, the defending champions. And in the current standings, let's have a quick check here. Game Racer flat out are in position number 2, second only to Flying Dutchman. So Ben Tusting in 3 through the S's and hunted down by Talborg in position number 2. And with something like that straight behind the pits between them, it's Marco Giuliato. And Giuliato was in 4 on the grid. He's up to 2, so he must be very, very, very happy with the race so far. And I think he's following Chris Jacques. I'm not quite sure, but I think it's Chris Jacques we see there for the Black Rebels. About to be lapped by Giuliato, who also has his lights on, so he's better seen in the rear mirror. And now he's obviously about to make that lapping maneuver with Chris Jacques. Yes, Jacques moves out of the way. Giuliato moves past, no problem there. And it says Giuliato in 1 on my screen, and I'm quite surprised, but yes, indeed, he has moved in 1 because Robin Johansson has obviously had an off moment that we have just missed because we were still following Giuliato. Robin Johansson is down in 2. He was race leader. He's down in 2, very, very close indeed to Tusting and Talborg. So we have number 2, 3, and 4 all nicely lined up for a fight, while now it's Giuliato's turn to be off the track here. So that just goes to show you how difficult it is to do a fast race here tonight. We have Giuliato into Melbourne hairpin, and we have Robin Johansson just out of the S's in the back at the same time, so that gives you an idea of the distance between them. Should be something like 4 seconds. And right now I need expert advice of Timmy. Timmy, my favorite squirrel. Are you still there? I mean, you've raced a lot in rain, obviously. I mean, I know your career and you're one of these rain guys. Now, do you think they will pit a second time? Or do you think that the tires will last now all through a rainy 1 hour? Okay, I'll give you some time. Maybe David can answer this question. David, since you're there too.
Wait, but before leaving, I would like to say hello to all the happy folks in the forums.
Okay. So, Davido, you're not really the kind of rain racer, obviously, down there in the south of Spain, but never mind. From your experience here in sim racing, would you say that these virtual tires will make it through an hour? I mean, everybody pitted in the first, after 20 minutes, 25 minutes, so they have about an hour or 70 minutes on these tires. Will they make it?
Well, you were totally right, Eckhart, and you said the difference from virtual to real. In the virtual world, I think I don't remember my last race on wet.
You chicken.
Lately, I'm racing e-racing, and there is no weather change.
Oh, they don't have wet. Serious drawback.
But I can tell you something. In my real experience on wet, I had many, and the wet tires are very, very soft. Way softer than a soft compound. I don't see a way that they can handle to make the tough tires complete the whole race.
All right, very good. So that means we're in for another round of pit stops, which I would be very happy about, because it really gives us a lot of chance to have the field totally mixed up and lots of interesting situations arising. So that would be then in, let's check my watch, in
the
about 10 occurred, to 15 minutes.
Let me interrupt you once again. The real problem, Eckhart, is that the track conditions are going back to damp.
Oh, they are.
And
that's a serious problem.
Yeah, this is the worst problem they could have right now on the wet tires, because wet tires could live a bit more on wet or heavy rain, but not on damp or on a race drying up.
Yeah, we see John McCartney at the pits, so he might be the first one to change back. To dries, really. On the other hand, I mean, we've seen that in the event so far. If you change back and forth and forth and back and back and forth, you're in deep water too, aren't you? You're really in trouble, because you just take too much time in the pits.
Yeah, unless you do it in the right moment.
Yep.
Two or three laps, even if the race areas are not completely realistic, but in real life, two or three laps on the right tires in the right moment can mean a lot of seconds, a lot of time.
It can make a lot of difference, indeed. All right, so there they go, Marco Giuliato, obviously, I think, still on wets, but I say obviously, but I suppose in wets, and look at that, Göran Johansson, he is... it's Robin Johansson, he is recovering. Cameraman just tells me that we are in what, P8?
No, P18, because I wanted P18? To do a round down where you were talking.
So our viewers have seen everyone on the grid, so that means it's time to go back to P1 and P2. No, it's not. Stay where you are, because the stuff that I have to tell you can just be told. It's Giuliato into the pits, and Robin Johansson back into the lead. And let's see if Johansson comes in pretty quickly now. Giuliato in the pits, Tusting into the pits as well. Reggie Blaine into the pits. Dinka Andre staying out. Nicola Dorigatti is now in 6. And Jesper Talborg in 7. Guys, in the background, I'm giving my cameraman, kind of, go to 7. There's a good fight there. And the moment I say it, one of the guys is into the pit. So it's pitting time again, just as we were discussing the various pros and cons here of different tire strategies. It's pitting time again. And things are changing rapidly, but chassé 3 and 4, it's Jesper Talborg for the Flying Dutchman, and it is Ben Tusting, who has pitted already for the second time in 4 for Game Racer flat out. I think he has pitted for a second time. I'm fairly sure. I'm not quite sure, but I'm fairly sure. And yes, at least on my screen, one can see it clearly now. The rain has stopped completely. Track is beginning to dry. And David, your expert opinion, having taken part in real-life events and also in many, many sim racing events, they promise that R Factor 2 will have a drying off line. Do you think that this is actually possible to really simulate it?
Yes, of course. And I think it's a way to do it. Correct. I mean, the way to get a wet track and the way back to get a dry track depends a lot on the surface that the cars are using on their laps, and yep. it has to be simulated as well as possible to get it real. And same goes for the dirty part of the track. Is yep. very different in what comes to grip from the clean part of the circuit. It is very yep. important if they want to make it real, Eckhart.
It is. I think it's well nigh impossible to make it real because there's just so many factors playing into the calculations, into the algorithms that have to run in the background. Because there's 24 guys out on the track. They're taking slightly different lines every single turn. And then some system has to put all that, crunch the numbers, and come up with a race line that dries up. I'd be very surprised if they manage to pull it off. But then again, I have no experience in real-life racing, so I wouldn't be one to judge. But I'd be looking at the forums, and I'd be checking out the guys who have experience, what they say about the drying off race line. If it works, it would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
Yeah, of course. It would be awesome. I think they could have a basic system, and maybe from that system they could improve it and add some different variations of it depending the lines of the cars, but they should consider a lot of things. As an example, Eckhart, the banking of the corner in real life when it rains, we have been talking about that on STC before. You know, the water goes to the lower part of the corner, and it used to be between the curb and it used to be in the driving line, in the driving line.
Yes.
There are a lot of variations.
There are. Well, let's just wait and see. With the first video out on R Factor 2, tensions, of course, rising, but right now it's not out, and right now we're still here in the STC with Race On. Well advanced in years, I must say, but still doing the job nicely. And I must check with my cameraman, Chaussé, which of the guys on the track are we following, and which position is that?
Well, we are with Ben Tusting now.
Brilliant. That's nice, because that's exactly what's happening on my screen. So then you also saw one of the Flying Dutchman development Audis completely battered going into the pits. I don't know who it was, but that car would stay in the pits for a long time, let me tell you. And Tusting in P3, down, of course, a little from where he was. And he is followed by Marco Giuliato for Course Online, and eager to make a move. But Tusting is in a lucky position that he has a lapped Game Racer Flat Out Club guy in front. That is Tom Ilsbrooks, if I'm not mistaken. So he could use him as a kind of cover between his Game Racer Flat Out Koenigsegg and an advancing Marco Giuliato. And then also there's Christer Larsson for Blue Flag in front of that group. So we'll see some very interesting maneuvers here in the next couple of laps with Blue Flag maneuvers there with Giuliato trying to catch up to Tusting. So some very close racing in the next couple of laps, I suppose.
I'm not sure, guys, but the timing under the name, it shows the personal best lap or the total best lap?
I'm not sure.
Because if it's the overall, Ben has made the fastest lap and it's already doing a second fastest lap now.
But then I am not completely sure about it, Jose, because in I think it is
the personal best.
Ray. Yeah, maybe personal best.
Yeah, and Tasting is moving up. Tasting is definitely on a run here because he's closing the gap to Jesper Talborg, who is in two. I mean, I think I can't stress that strongly enough. He used to be, I mean, he was in 20 at the beginning of the game, and he's now up in two here tonight at Donington, and still moving strong. He's now approaching one of the Gubkluben guys, one of the Gubkluben UD guys. They're lapping him easily. And we've lost all track of Robin Johansson. He must have run into some trouble somewhere along the line. We have Dinka André still in position number one for Water Blue. Jesper Talborg in position number two for Flying Dutchman Racing. And then the guy we've been following for a long time, Ben Tusting, in three, trying to get closer to Talborg, trying to get within striking distance. In four, Marco Giuliato, course online. He was off the track a little bit just now, so he lost a bit of space there. And I suppose while the camera stays more in the front with Tusting and Talborg, I will go on my screen. I will go hunting for Robin Johansson and see where he is at and what he's doing.
By the way, guys, the fastest lap has been set by Jesper Talborg right now.
Okay, he's feeling the pressure.
And the second fastest lap is done by Marco
David,
Giuliato.
I think I just made a new fastest lap now.
And Johansson is out of the race. Johansson, Robin Johansson is out of the race. That is a serious blow to Gubkluben and also a serious blow to their championship. Points here. It wasn't on our screen. We didn't catch it. Sorry, guys. We can't be at all places at all times. But just to keep you updated, Robin Johansson is out of the race. The only thing that gives us a clue to what may have happened is that Nick Dealey of Flying Dutchman Development crawled into the pits with a completely battered Audi. So let's hope there wasn't a tussle there in a blue flag maneuver between Dealey and Johansson. I hope not. We have no confirmation at all of that might have taken place, but that these events must have been rather close in time. So Johansson is out, and that leaves Daniel Beck, the fastest of the Gubkluben guys on the grid, leaves him in position 7, which is not where the Gubklubens want to be.
So, Jose, as you were saying, Dink André made his personal best again, and still the fastest guy on the track is Jesper Talborg.
With Gubkluben player Johansson out of the counting, it's Reggie Blaine in 6, fighting for position with Martijn van Bommel in 5. And these are very close together. And van Bommel, one of the guys who had to come from way behind. And we see in the background, we see Daniel Beck in 7 for Gubkluben. So he's still within striking distance of these two. And van Bommel here, I think he has just moved past Reggie Blaine, because Reggie Blaine seems to have serious problems with the handlings of his Gumpert Apollo. And fancy that there is an Audi under that skin in real life. It's based on an Audi. And Doesn't look like it at all. And Van Bommel now moving away from Reggie Blaine, in fact. Again, we seem to have not the best of luck here with spotting the fights on the grid, because just as we move the camera there, fight seems to have been resolved with Martin Van Bommel in 5 and Reggie Blaine in 6. And in the background, we still see Christer Larsson for blue flag, and we also see other players that are further down the grid, but still fighting here, still going strong, while we already have lost 5 of the cars on the grid. We're down to 19 still running here at a very wet Donington.
Eckhart.
Yep.
I have news from Gubkluven, from Goran Johansson, that is on the...
Oh, interesting.
On the box. I think you were right about your idea about what happened to Robin. Goran told me that some lap driver was off, then re-entered and hit Robin. And looks like Robin is quite upset right now.
Oh, dear. Oh, yeah, that's very... Yeah, very, very bad news indeed. I mean, these things do happen, and it's always a huge, big shame, because there's no guy out there, nobody participating in the STC who wants that to happen, but it just happens. And so very, very bad news indeed for Robin Johansson. So, yes, we don't know which of the other guys it was. We're not making any conclusions here. We're not saying anything. And so, bad luck for Robin Johansson, and thank you, Gubkluven, for giving us this information here while that broadcast is still going on. And also now we have Alexandre Gaetano out of the game, so we're down to 18. Must be really difficult to just keep it together here on the track at Donington. And Van Bommel here following, I think, Chris Jacques. For Black Rebels, and about to do a lapping maneuver, while Reggie Blaine is still trying to follow him.
Yes, and Reggie is coming faster now. I think he's closing the gap with at least in this last lap he did.
Okay. And it's in fact Andreas Loffler, the yellow of the Black Rebels. Sorry, I do get you guys mixed up. The yellow car of the Black Rebels, that's Andreas Loffler for tonight. And so it is Andreas Loffler there. And yes, we're down to 19 with John McCartney in 19, just to give you an update on that. And the guys are fairly far apart here, everyone stuck in his own race, everyone trying just to stay in control here with the bad weather. And indeed, the closest fight here is Martin Van Bommel, and right now we see a Gubkluven UD out on the grass to have that lapping maneuver happen without any problems, and Loeffler between Van Bommel and Blaine, and Blaine still trying to stick to Van Bommel, still trying to be able to follow his pace. So, while the players are a bit apart, just a bit of information, just some data on the track. I think you all know it, Donington. There was talk of a huge restoration program, of a rebuilding of the track, of a completely change of the layout, but if I'm right, that never happened. I think they ran into problems with the financial crisis, there was no credit available. And they have restored the track. The track is back in working order. It was, I think, out of order for 1 or 2 years. And it's used again now, at least for motorbikes. And but also I think the British Touring Car Championship hosted an event there, but I'm not quite sure about that. So it's back in working order, but it's still the same layout, still the same layout that we've had for the last couple of years with the Melbourne hairpin, bringing the track up to the desired 4.023 kilometers or 2.5 miles exactly, because that's the length you need for MotoGP. And that's why they built the Melbourne hairpin. Melbourne hairpin used to be in a completely different place. Originally, if you follow the start and finish straight, as Martijn van Bommel is doing now, the first turn is called Red Gate, but originally the track went on straight on for another 200, 300 meters. Then we had Melbourne hairpin. Then the track went back in the direction it came from. We had to start and finish there, actually. And then we had Redgate, which in those years, way back in the time before the Second World War, was a left-hander. It's one of the turns that in the history of racing has changed from a left-hander into, well, not really a double right-hander, but a slightly double right-hander. So that's... the track was had a different layout. It was spread over two counties, in fact. And then somebody decided administration was much easier if it was just stuck within one county of Great Britain. And so they simply cut off the part that was in the other county. And that was that part leading out to the original Melbourne. And that's how we came to have the track layout we have today. For those of you who've never been there, if you go to England the next time, visit it. They've got a very nice museum of racing cars and racing bikes right next to the pits, so really where the action is. It's that building as you go around Goddard's. That's the building that houses the museum, so it's a very nice indeed. Very nice layout there, and very interesting exhibition of cars. I don't know if it's still there, actually. That was on the old layout before these restorations took place, but that's at least the way it was. And Donington, I think most of the sim racing players like it because of the flowing layout. And David, if you follow my ramblings, isn't it nice to go through Craner curves? I think one of the loveliest passages out there, isn't it?
Yeah, of course. Nice combination, it's amazing.
Yep, and then very difficult to hit the last one.
There used to be a lot of mistakes and crashes in sim racing, overtaking in the last hairpin before before going up to the museum for the back of the museum. In this last, I don't know the name, but in this last
Melbourne.
Ah, yeah, Melbourne hairpin. There used to be a lot of. Polemic moves in sim racing, especially.
Yes, especially because it was easy to do a slightly dirty move in that happened because the approach was downhill and you really gather speed as you go downhill, and also the S's in front, the S's that you take just before, it's quite easy to not get a good exit there, and then that of course follows up the run up to Melbourne. And yes, I've seen many not so nice maneuver there. I've also done one or two where I totally lost my breakpoint and then you just go into the guys taking the turn. It's always sad, of course, and you don't want to do that, but it just happens.
Eckhart,
yes.
you were saying before that you never had any real-life racing experience. Why don't you live in Germany, why don't you go to a track day? And at least it's not racing experience, but you can test your abilities with in sim racing in the real life and see if you find it similar or not, or I don't know.
Yeah, it would be interesting proposition. I thought about doing it in Zandvoort in Holland, which would be the closest of the good racetracks to where I live. And but I don't know. I've done kart, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, really, really enjoyed it. And it gave me an impression of what you are up against in a real car. I mean, I was, after 10 minutes or 20 minutes in the car, I was completely sweated through. And listen, I do the marathon, so I'm quite sportive. I was utterly exhausted. My hands were shaking, my legs were shaking. And the adrenaline was just awesome. It was pumping all through my body. I could have torn out whole trees, I think. And after that, I thought, I don't think I'll ever really want to go into a real race car. If that happens in a kart, I don't know what would happen in a real race car. So I'm more of the cautious guy.
Well,
can I tell you something, Eckhart?
Yes, go ahead.
I think there is nothing worse than a go-kart.
Yes.
I mean, from a go-kart up, everything becomes comfortable.
The car. Well, is it?
Yeah.
except the quite powerful Formula cars, then it's worse.
But as an example, a Formula One has suspension, has help direction, for the direction. I don't know. The cart is a piece of steel with four wheels. You know, it's.
I know. I know when I tried yours, and you go like 125 kilometers per hour in a cart, the impression is quite big. It's not the same that do it in a normal car. But
yep.
I've tried high G-force once in a bobsleigh.
Oh,
whoa!
You brave man!
And that is it was, of course, the bobsleigh was run by professionals, and you can go as passenger.
And some passenger.
Yeah, and well, with that are similar G forces than a Formula One car. And it really, you really black out sometimes. If you don't put your neck really, really strong when cornering, you can suffer blackouts. And that was like 1 minute downhill. So imagine in a 90-minute race, you really have to be fit to resist that in a Formula One.
Yep, and we're a bit off the topic here, and we'll go back to the race. Don't worry, guys, we'll go back to the race, but we're slightly off topic. But I just have to voice this. Sometimes on forums, sim racing forums, I find people making remarks about the backbenchers in Formula One, the guys who race HRT and the guys who are in the Green Lotus team and the guys who are in Marussia Virgin. And I mean, come on. This is still a fantastic achievement, keeping a beast like that on the gray stuff for 90 minutes in something like 45 degrees temperature outside and 60, 70 degrees in the cockpit. I couldn't do it for 5 minutes. I would just either faint or smash the thing into one of the barriers. That would be the end of it. And I have the greatest respect for these chaps bringing it home just one or two laps down to Sebastian Vettel, who is just a phenomenon. And all these guys up in front are a phenomenon. And really, when I read these very disrespectful posts, that's not my style. It's an achievement that they do there. It's outstanding, I think. And I couldn't do that for 10 minutes. Anyway, there's my heartfelt feelings about backbenchers in Formula One. And back to the race here at hand. Sorry, guys, we were a bit off topic, but I hope you forgive us. And Chaussee, 6 and 7 is where the action is.
Okay, I'm going there, but now I see Tom Ilfrucks went out in one of the first corners of the track. I don't know.
Yep, I saw it too. And that was close to 6 and 7 because he was, I think, trying to make way in a blue flag maneuver as he saw Reggie Blaine in 6 and Daniel Beck in 7. Fighting it out here. That is the closest fight at the moment on the grid here in the STC in Donington. So while we were talking, you obviously missed something, but you didn't really miss very much. Players having their hand full here in the wet conditions, but still drying up conditions. And but none really close together, but this is really close racing. Daniel Beck in 7, putting the pressure on Reggie Blaine. And both of them really struggling here as they head out of the S's, struggling to find the grip there on the still damp track. It's no longer wet, it's only damp, but it should be difficult enough to find your grip, especially, I should suppose, in the Gumpert Apollo, which is not an easy ride. in the sim racing world in normal conditions, which I personally find very, very difficult to do in the wet. Indeed, there's very little reaction time. It's all over the place. If you make a wrong move, it runs really nice and smooth if you make the right moves, and that's obviously what Reggie's doing here, because he knows what he's doing other than me. But it is very difficult indeed. And the Corvette, we've seen that in the last couple of events here for STC, is much better than we anticipated in the wet, doing a much better job in the wet than we thought. And right now, Reggie Blaine has Daniel back all over his back. Yes, I've got back all over my back. Ha ha ha.
Eckhart, tell us.
Yeah.
How much Chevrolet pays you for the advertised Corvette?
I don't know. I just love it. You gotta love it. You simply gotta love it. Marco Giuliato is out of the game. Very, very, very bad news indeed for Corse Online. He played a good role in the racing so far tonight, and he was heading for some serious points for Corse Online, and he's out of the game now. I think we're down to 17 guys here in Donington. And Reggie Blaine now, very erratic. While I think Beck is driving like the proverbial Swiss, in this case Swedish clockwork, Reggie Blaine has some very, very fast passages, and then again some not so fast passages. And this brings Daniel back closer, and then makes him move away again a little. And I should say, I should really be paid by the Gumpert guys, by the Gumpert Apollo guys, because remember when the GTR Evo came out, they put some of the names from the community on the rides, and my name was on one of the Gumpert Apollos. And I had some serious problems the first night I played the game. Of course, I went to my car, and it was so difficult to handle, I nearly gave up.
They did it on purpose, to annoy you.
I suppose so, they did, yeah. They lumped me in with some Swedish lady, I don't know, obviously a secretary at Simbin or someone. I have no idea. I tried to Google her, I never found a name, but Lisa Wickland. But I think they did it on purpose to stop me from playing these games.
But I think for David it was worse, because he was also in a game, but I think he had a Mini or something like that.
No. What did you have?
I had a Gumpert Apollo.
Oh dear.
Yeah, it was quite good. Can't complain.
But Reggie Blaine can complain, because there he goes, out of Melbourne, and now he is in serious trouble with Daniel Beck starting an attack. Oh dear, I'm rhyming all the way. Starting to feel like a rapper here. Anyway, Reggie Blaine with Daniel Beck starting an attack as they head into Goddard's, but then Blaine could fend him off for another half lap here. And now they're into another lap. And Daniel Beck is making some serious moves here. And is making putting some very high pressure on Reggie Blaine. And Blaine does an awesome, an expert job here at defending. But now they run into two lapped cars. That's... let me have a quick look. It's Nick Dealey for Flying Dutchman Development. And he is off the track now, obviously, to make way. And it's, I think it was Adam Shaw for Flat Out also making way there, going onto the grass. And that went pretty well for Blaine, because he managed to put some, I think, 100, 150 meters between his Apollo and Beck's Corvette.
I wonder myself, Eckhart, is people really freaking out with the lapping maneuvers? Because I see lots of the cars going to the grass to make the fastest cars lap with a clean move. And well,
yeah, I mean
that's
problem.
Too much.
It is definitely too much. I think we do have a lapping discussion here going on at the STC, and we must come to some conclusion for the next round, for the next tournament, and I'm not happy with what I see here, because with guys on the grass, that is not, sim racing the way I see it. But that's on the forum. I'm not going to discuss it here, being the outside objective commentator at the moment, and you will see my personal views on the forums. But yes, I agree with you. I totally agree with you. I should say that's not exactly what we want to see. But I'm doing it as well, actually, moving onto the grass. It just feels safe.
Yes, but I mean, not. I know you have. We have maybe not total, but in some parts different points of view. But from the point of view of the simulation, if somebody is really into the simulation, that's not real at all. I mean, you will never see a real car being lapped going to the grass. Never.
Nope.
And guys, less with the wet grass.
Yes.
Oh yes. And talking of simulation, this is amazing what Blaine and Beck are doing here. This is very, very, very close. Finally, look at that. Beck is all over the place as he tries to avoid hitting Blaine coming out of Melbourne hairpin. Blaine had some serious trouble in the two turns just in front of that, just before that, with trying to keep Beck behind. And racing here.
A car in the background, flat-out club car went off, I think.
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. If it was flat-out club,
Adam Shaw.
I think it was Adam Shaw, yep.
Yeah.
Well, that's flat-out proper. That's flat-out proper. That's the basic team.
By the way, guys, I don't know if you talked about Waterblue Racing and Dink André, but I think it is a brilliant and
absolutely
outstanding performance.
Absolutely. And here we have a flat-out club with some more problems. That's Nathan Aljo, I suppose. But yeah, let's, with these two a bit apart now, Jose, by all means, let's go back to Dinka and give him some airtime, because that is absolutely brilliant. And it's great news for the overall standings, because it'll put the field much closer together.
Of course it is.
And you can all be very thankful for Jose, ever thoughtful Jose, who told us David and Eckhart on the Whisper. Would one of you please check the time? Talking about real-life racing, talking about lapping maneuvers, talking about all kinds of stuff, you seem to have forgotten the time. And yes, we nearly did. It's only 3 minutes to go here at Donington for the STC, round number 4 or 5. I'm not quite sure at the moment.
Four,
thank you very much indeed, Jose. Round number 4, and it's Dink André leading the race here and about to score a win for Waterblue Racing. And before I say something wrong, Jose, is this the first win for the Greek team, Waterblue Racing?
Yes, it is, and I think they are the underdogs of
perfect,
STC.
Perfect. It's a bit like in real-life racing Formula 1, one of the teams that, well, Williams, but Force India, one of these teams winning a race, Paul Uresta at the top of the grid. So Dinka André showing an absolutely brilliant performance and forcing poor Torrent guy. That was, I think, John McCartney into a half spin here as he zoomed past him. Dink André, a superb, outstanding night of racing for him. And he's on his way to the first, we think, the first win of Waterblue Racing in the STC. And that is, of course, a fantastic moment. Race control tells me the lap we are about to witness is now, he's in the second to last, and he will start on the last lap as he moves across the start and finish line with only a minute or so to go before the race finishes.
I have been talking with Yuri Braham from Playing Dutchman a while ago, I have been in their box, and they were crossing fingers to see if Jesper Talborg was able to catch Dink and Ray, but the gap is still around 15 seconds, so it's much.
Yep. Very much. It is really...
But the performance, second, from Jesper as well.
20 to 2, that must be the second most outstanding performance of the race. The first one is Dinka Andre. I mean, P3 on the grid from Pagani Zonta that we didn't expect up there at all. And then leading the race for a lot of the time, and then defending against someone like Robin Johansson from Gudklubben, and putting Ben Tusting of Game Racer flat out in position number 3 with not even a chance of getting close. And absolutely outstanding. He's through the S's now.
You know what, Eckhart?
Yes.
We'll try to get Georgios Davakos, the team manager, in the interviews.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, would be nice. Would be nice. So Dinka now, out of Melbourne hairpin, up behind the pits towards Goddard's for the last time. And you guys at Waterloo Racing, pop the champagne, hopefully the real one, not the virtual one, as Andre now moves out onto the start and finish, and as we think this is time to celebrate, no, I didn't see a black and white flag. I can still see him going, but I can see him going very slow indeed.
You have to trust
the race win.
Race control.
It's the race win. Yeah, I should trust race control rather than Simbin. That little figure there didn't pull out the black and white flag, but it's a win for Dink. Well done. Absolutely fantastic.
Yes, and P2 for Jesper, P3 for Ben.
And very close together. Very, very close together. I think that Jesper had a little off moment in one of the last laps because they were much further apart. And it's Martin van Bommel finishing a great night for Flying Dutchman Racing, which will keep them in position number 1 for sure. At least for another week. Martin van Bommel in position number 4, following, I think, Erling Böhmer here a lap down for Gudklubben UD. Then Daniel Beck, saving as many points as possible, and he managed to squeeze past Reggie somewhere along the line. Sorry we didn't catch that, but we had to give the race leaders some air space. And then Reggie Blaine in 6, and Nicola Dorigatti. Last course online on the grid, sorry about that, and he is in 7. Yes, please.
No, I was saying accident there, but...
Yeah, that was just after the... Okay, that's it, guys. Let me just give you the number of guys who were still on the grid when the race finished. If I'm not mistaken, it was 17. 17 out of 24 managed to make it through to the finish line. And that, I think, is a great result in itself. So, we're waiting for the interviews. Time for me to get some water and have a drink. So while we're waiting for the interviews, let me give you a quick rundown of, well, just a rough idea of the overall standings, with the Flying Dutchman having two of their cars in the top 5. They will definitely still retain their lead and even get more of an advantage over Game Racer Flat Out Racing, because they had... because they had only Ben Tusting in the top positions, and then Adam Shaw further down the grid. But if I saw that correctly, he was he finished the race, which gives them, of course, some points, and which does help a lot indeed. And then Gubkloben, they lost one of their cars. They lost Johansson. So they should lose some position. But also AB Racing, who were in five, lost one guy along the way. And then Game Racer Flat Out Club, I think, got both of them back. And so they should be making a move up. And from then on, Waterloo Racing, they were down in eight. They should move up a lot, because not only did they have the race win, but also they had the second car in contention. That was, let me quickly grab the name here, Michael Chabot. If I managed to see it correctly, he was still in the top 10 by the time we finished at Donington. So he should also get some nice points there.
Thanks.
For them. So, my interview partners are coming in, but we're still missing somebody from Waterloo Racing, but I hope and I think that Race Control is working on it. But
yes, Eckhart,
yes,
Waterloo Racing, they have microphone problems. They probably they didn't expect it to win today, and they have no way to talk, so they can't be here.
All right. Well, that leaves us with somebody very pleasant to talk to, Ben Tusting of Game Racer Flat Out Club, and Martin van Bommel of Flying Dutchman Racing. First of all, Ben Tusting, congratulations to what I think was position number 3 at the end of the race, wasn't it? Bronze medal.
That was
medal.
Correct, yes.
And not quite where you wanted to be, because you were on pole at the beginning of the race.
I know, it was pretty annoying, really. If it stayed dry, I think we could have possibly won, but the car doesn't seem... I personally can't drive the car that well in the wet, really.
Ah, okay.
It's a bit of pain.
That sounds so good to an ears of some to somebody like me who has problems in dry but has serious problems in wet. So it's nice that one of the top guys suffers as well. A very comforting thought, Ben. so you suffered and you still managed to get down to 3. And the track then, it dried up, but it never really went away from them. Did you start on slicks?
I did start on slicks, yeah.
So obviously, like almost everybody else, you changed to wets and then changed back in the second stop.
Yeah, I changed back to slicks right at the end, yeah.
Okay, and Martijn, is it Martijn or Martijn?
Martijn.
Martijn, Martijn. Okay, I'll try that. My best Dutch pronunciation, Martijn. Martijn, you ended up in 4, if I'm not mistaken, coming from the back of the grid. How difficult was it and how fast did you get to the front?
Well, it was very, very difficult. In the beginning, with weather getting worse, I managed to keep up with my teammate, but he was so fast passing those guys.
He was amazing.
Oh, unbelievable. But in the end, halfway through, I switched to wets, then back to slicks, and the race kind of came to me. And unfortunately, he made one little mistake, but in the end, fourth place from P22, still an amazing...
Fantastic. And you had a huge fight with Reggie Blaine the last 10 laps or so. And
yeah.
I'm afraid we didn't catch it on the screen, but where did you manage to slip past?
In the right-hander up to the chicane. He was running a little bit wide, I think.
Coppice, yep.
And then I passed him, and I managed to pull a little bit of a gap. And then I made a spin in the same chicane a couple of laps later, and he bumped right into me. so the two of us were back together again.
Right. So that was some very close fight. We had some of it on the screen. So look forward to the replay and to the broadcast. So some fantastic racing there. And yes, Jesper was outstanding. I'm afraid we don't have him on the interview either.
He was amazing.
Yep, so that was brilliant from 19 or 20 or somewhere in the back. I think I had 21, and then all the way up to the podium to 2. So you managed to defend your leading position in the overall standing. So well done, Flying Dutchman Racing. And
thank you.
Next time, do your allocations on time.
Yeah, believe me, I will make that very, very clear.
Yeah, you should get a second race director. It definitely helps.
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you all. Yes, David.
Yeah, wait for 1 second because I have a little press note from Waterloo Racing that can't be here with us.
Yes, let's hear it from the boys.
I will read it fast. So these are the words from Giorgio Zavacco saying that Waterloo Racing is really happy with their first win, and they are very happy to be in STC. They would like to thank Dinka for an awesome performance and his positive attitude. it's positive stuff.
Whatever that means.
They say that it was a heavy gamble that paid off during the race when they noticed that everybody was on slicks.
Okay.
So they started on wets then?
Sounds like it.
Yeah, I think I was on wets since the start.
Yes, and I remember he stayed out when everybody else went in. And then I think he only pitted once, but I'm not quite sure.
Yes, but Giorgio confirmed to me that he has been on wet tires for the whole race.
Well. The gamblers. Very well done indeed. Very well done indeed. So the gamble played off, and the weather system helped us have a really, really interesting event here at Donington. And well then, Ben Tusting and Martijn van Bommel, thank you very much for dropping in on the interview. Congratulations again to position number 3 and 4. Absolutely well done in these conditions.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And while I'm thanking everybody, thanks to Chaussé for perfect camera work and for putting us online with something like 5 seconds or so to go.
Thanks to you, Egard, for being there as well and doing a great commentary.
Hope so. And thanks to David for 3 laps in our green pace car.
You're welcome, Egard.
And helping us out with his expert knowledge in real life and sim racing. And thanks to Timi for dropping in again. And Timi, it's up to you to say goodbye to the folks and wish everybody well till we meet again next week, Thursday night, for Most in either the Czech Republic or Slovakia. I'm not quite sure.
Yes, of course. I am always there.
Thank you, Timmy. Bye-bye, everybody. This is STC. Bye-bye.